Speaking of paying employees, where do you find your employees at?
Pick them up at the bar. I figure the guys that are drunk leaving at 2 a.m., those are the ones that we can... no, actually, those guys usually don't last very long. We actually had a customer in Southern Indiana that told us that's how he always got his drivers. He would actually go bail them out of jail and then work them for a few days, but...
Hello again, everyone, for the second episode of Custom Harvest Hype. My name is Mandi, and I'm the operations manager for U.S. Custom Harvesters, an organization that has custom harvest crews as members and also the businesses that make products and services to support those harvesters. We have new episodes uploaded every other Wednesday, so make sure you check us out on Apple, Google, Spotify, wherever you listen to podcasts, and of course, our YouTube page. Just search for U.S. Custom Harvesters. Today, we are going to chat with Jon Orr from Apple Creek, Ohio. He's a forage harvester. And then later on, we'll chat with David Misener from Elk City, Oklahoma of Green Acres Enterprises. He's a grain harvester and also the president of our board of directors. And so we're just going to check in with them, see where they're currently located, what they've been up to this year. And the main topic of that conversation is going to be how you got started being a custom harvester and any advice for anyone looking to get into the industry. But first, we have to start out with our first segment, which is, where are you? Every Monday on the U.S. Custom Harvesters Facebook page, we post a Moving Monday post. So make sure if you're a custom harvester, member of U.S. Custom Harvesters, that you comment on that post. Let us know where you're at and what crop you are chopping, cutting, picking, shelling, whatever you're doing. And I will mention it on the next podcast that we post. So let me update you on a couple of the crews. JC Skimper of Skimper Harvesting is at home in Holdridge, Nebraska, picking corn. I have an update from Paplo Harvesting. They are cutting corn, shelling, picking, whatever you call it. It's a regional dialect, people, okay? So around here, I call it cutting. Paul is cutting corn in Hartley, Iowa, Worthington, Minnesota, and also Brookings and Roscoe, South Dakota. He's got a couple different crews out there. High Plains Harvesting is in Sharon Springs, Tribune, Kansas area, that far western Kansas area. They are starting Milo, and they are mostly done with corn in southern Nebraska. David Misener is in Gregory, South Dakota in rain, which we will talk to him later, actually, as it's raining. Fray's Brothers is a grain and forage crew. He is cutting corn in Sharon Springs in Leota, Kansas, and they're also chopping sorghum for silage in Gove, Kansas, and Guymon, Oklahoma. C&K Harvesting, or Churneys, if you guys know them, they're in Blackwell, Oklahoma, cutting soybeans. New Millers have a couple different crews. Logan and Cole are in West Hope, North Dakota. Michael is in Fessenden, North Dakota. Rogers in Lemon, South Dakota, and they also have a crew in Kinsel, North Dakota. All crews are cutting soybeans. Mark Anderson, who is also one of my board members, he is heading to Perryton, Texas to chop sorghum also. Sorghum, Milo, whatever you want to call it. I know that the Zimmerman crew is down in South Texas by Houston picking cotton. Dyke Cotton Harvesting, which is another one of my board members. John is in Seagraves, Texas at home getting ready to both pick and strip some cotton. One of these times in a podcast, I'll talk to you guys about the difference between picker and stripper cotton. But for now, John's getting ready to do both. Van Driesten's, which are actually a Canadian crew. They are in Verona, North Dakota, finishing up on beans and starting corn. And the last one I have for you guys is Shippers Harvesting is done chopping in Dalhart, Texas. And they are in the Muleshoe, Clovis, New Mexico area, chopping corn and getting ready to start on Milo and feed. Again, Milo, grain, sorghum, whatever you call it in your area, another regional dialect. So there's a quick update on where a lot of the custom harvesting crews are at right now and what they're up to. Next, we're going to chat with Jon Orr about what he's been up to this year and how he got started in the forage harvesting industry. All right, guys, we've got Jon Orr from Orson Custom Farming on with us. Jon, introduce yourself. Tell us about your current silage operations.
Jonathan Orr from Apple Creek, Ohio. We chop silage from Georgia, Ohio, and Michigan. Right now we're sitting in Michigan, rained out.
How many choppers do you have?
Two.
And they are Krone. What model number?
Krone 1180s, 14 row heads. And then we have Krone Big M, H&S mergers, Freightliner semi-tractors, Moss trailers, Fendt tractors, Case IH tractors, a little bit of everything.
Have you always had Fendt, or did you just get one this year?
I've had Fendt for about 20 plus years.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, we were an early adapter.
Ah. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about basically how you got started custom harvesting and then kind of got your kids into it, a couple of them. Your dad, correct me if I'm wrong, did your dad do it?
We had our family had a dairy farm. And so when they'd buy a silage cutter, it was always, you know, plenty big for their own stuff. And they'd run around the neighborhood and do some in the neighborhood. So that's kind of led to, hey, this is what we like to do more than the dairy cattle. So when I came into the partnership, the cows weren't really my love. The equipment was. The iron intrigued me, not the black and white things that crapped on me. So I'm G-rated.
To be expected.
Thank you. We looked at options, and we were farming more acres than we are now today, but we decided the cows could go. Budgets would work. Cows would go. Chopper would come in, a bigger chopper. A whopper chopper, essentially, rather than the smaller ones we had. And that got us kicked off into that business. So it was kind of my deal on making this our full-time deal, full-time gig, I guess you'd say. It's a Excel spreadsheet that I played around with for years and years. And title was John's Dream, so I guess it was kind of my deal.
That's really what you called your spreadsheet?
That's what it was. It was John's Dream. I could still find it on an old computer, probably, if I dig for it.
That's pretty cool. What age were you when you got that first like big loan, like, holy crap, I'm really doing this?
We went on the road in 97 and traveled. That was the first out of the area. So that was the first, holy crap, we're really doing this. Got away from home. We were 8 hours from home that time. So that was, this is serious now, I guess, if that answers your question. That was that first moment. But for me, it kind of, you know, it was dad and I. My kids came in 4 years ago. I think if I look at Mo, she'll say yes on that. 4 years ago, the kids, two of my kids came into ownership. This last time when we traded choppers, it kind of hit me. Because it was like, holy crap, we're signing this $2 million note. And it's not me hiding underneath dad's umbrella. It's me holding the umbrella and the kids are underneath mine. So it kind of hit me a little harder this last time. But yeah, it's been a fun ride. And all three kids are in custom harvesting. It's just two of them are in the business with me. And one of them is in Minnesota where he followed his woman to.
His woman. How old were you on that first trip when you traveled 8 hours away?
I would have been, 97. I would have been 26. Yeah.
What are you going to do if Mo's not there to help you answer questions?
I have a Mo that keeps track of all this. That's, yeah, all her paperwork laying around here that she's been working on this morning. She,
Mo is John's wife.
Yes. Mo is the brains behind it, does all the paperwork.
I would agree with that.
And drives truck.
I would agree with that. Superstar. How much does a chopper, new chopper, cost these days?
You can get them over $1 million pretty quick. If you put your two heads, a hay head, a corn head, and a silage cutter, you'll be real close to $1 million if you're not careful. That's what the else? Cheap part. You know, you start adding for each one of those, you ought to have six semis just to haul the feed away. So six semis, six silage trailers, a couple pushing tractors for each one. And then the people to sit in the seats.
Plus all the overhead, fuel, parts,
fuel,
grease.
Fuel trailers, our parts trailers. We upgraded parts trailers this winter and we're filling them back up with a bunch more stuff because they're bigger so we can put more in. And yeah, the dollar value that's inside the parts trailers is kind of spooky.
And you keep those well locked everywhere you are.
Yeah, they do have a lock on the hitch, a GPS tracker. And
what would you say if a 20-year-old came up to you and was like, I've worked at dairies, I really want to be a custom forage harvester, how do I get started?
Get on a crew, travel with them, experience it, learn what they're going to do. And it might not just be one crew. You maybe need to get on one crew and then, you know, ride on that one for a year or two and then go to another. But be honest with them and say, hey, you know, I'm really wanting to be in this business and I want to work for you for a couple of years and learn from you. I think that's where you're going to start, because it's a lot more to it. I mean, we bought our first chopper. It was $325,000, which was a lot of money 27 years ago, 28 years ago. It was a lot of money, but it wasn't a million. And trucks were, you know, you pick trucks up for $5,000, $8,000, $10,000 for a tandem and put a dump bed on it for $10,000. And hey, you got salvage cutting operation going on here. It's a whole new scheme of it here. When you start talking about these dollar figures that we're looking at, you probably want to examine your head a little bit before you jump into it. But then you want to know what you're getting into and you know, get the numbers, figure that out. I mean, that Excel spreadsheet we laughed about, but you know, I took it right down to, okay, the chopper payment's going to be this. My insurance is going to be that. My people are going to cost me this to hire people. And you know, how many tons do I got to cut before I even begin to break even?
Right.
And, you know, where is my break even point? And, you know, get some of that knowledge. A lot of people just go out and buy a chopper and get a couple tractors and trailers and I'm a salvage.
They just kind of wing it. Yeah. And winging it, not a good idea.
Yeah. They're charging these numbers that just make no sense. And then they're like, hey, why can't I buy my next new chopper? Why this one's wore out and I'm broke. Yep. You didn't do any of the background homework to figure out what you were doing.
Speaking of paying employees, where do you find your employees at?
Pick them up at the bar. I figure the guys that are drunk leaving at 2 a.m. Those are the ones that we can. No, actually, those guys usually don't last very long. We actually had a customer in Southern Indiana that told us that's how he always got his drivers. He would actually go bail them out of jail and then work them for a few days. But
quality
employees. That was 20 some years ago. But we use USCHI. We have an ad on our website,
Tushy's
website. Word of mouth. I've been getting a couple from, you know, you got a good employee and he says, hey, I got a friend and you want to talk to my friend, and that helps, but never enough. We're considering some J1s for next year. We've done H2As in the past. Didn't love that program. I don't know.
You like it even less now.
Yes. It's getting harder and harder. And just in Ohio, our housing inspectors wouldn't pass a camper. So we're staying in hotels anyways, but the laws regarding which hotel I'm allowed to be in and health department inspections, all that, just it would have required me to lie. We jumped out of the H2A just because of that. And yeah, I'm not going to lie to the government because the penalties are outrageous. And I was smart enough to look at the fact that a couple of the presidents at USCHI had been nipped pretty hard through investigations by Department of Labor and visiting them. And I was coming into that realm of being one of the USCHI's presidents. And I thought that was going to be kind of expensive for me if I was lying about which hotels I was going to stay in, and they figured out where I actually stayed. So I said, let's just drop out of this.
To clarify, if anyone wants to work for you, I'm sure the hotels you stay in are quality hotels.
We're great hotels, but you have to have that hotel on your application when you apply for the application all the way back in October of the previous year. Yeah, we're staying in a Best Western, beautiful West Western right now in DeWitt, Michigan. I don't stay in cockroach motels. You got to have clean, comfortable, and safe hotels.
Speaking of safe, that was going to be my next question. I know you're a big, big safety guy. Talk about the safety videos that you helped to make for U.S. Custom Harvesters, and then just a little bit about kind of why you're big on safety. Because when I did go see Glenn Jansen, another former board president, a week or two ago, a couple weeks ago in Nebraska, and he was chopping for a big dairy up there. I mean, there's so many, he doesn't let people back up. You know, anytime I got out and walked somewhere, someone walked with me, because there's trucks, there's tractors, there's, you know, if you're at the pile, there's trucks here, tractors there. It's dangerous. So talk about kind of your view on safety.
Well, we can buy a new tractor. We can buy a new truck. We can replace all that stuff with a phone call, but that person is not replaceable. And Glenn knows that very well. He lost his son in an accident. And, you know, that's something that he wakes up with every morning. And I know employers that have lost an employee due to an accident, and that's something they wake up with every morning and thinking about what if, what could I have done? You gotta really take that to heart and lead by example. And you know, we've had guys that didn't want to stop at stop signs, and we preach and preach and preach and lecture and lecture and lecture. And it they just have to stop. I mean, that's the first thing. You stop at a stop sign. You talked about, you know, when you're out of the vehicle, walk. If you walk on our bunker, if we're chopping silage and you walk on our bunker, all my tractors stop. You know, nobody's moving, even if they're up on top of the pile. Everybody just stops. Everybody sits there and watches. If you want to come get a sample out of the pile, my equipment's sitting still because it's just too easy for something. Oh, well, that person over there can move because you're way away from them. Accidents happen way too quick. So you just got to slow down, take your time, make sure you're paying attention to everything. I started wearing high vis shirts while I'm at work. And I, you know, we have rules. If you get out of the vehicle and you're on the road, you got to have your yellow vest on. And we're starting to move that more towards even when you're working. The problem is you get them stained up, so you get so ugly. After you wore a yellow shirt 3 days, you look like a bum off the street, but all the stains and all. But the safety videos, that was something that I wanted to do when I got on Yushi. They talked about it, and I say, I'll take that on. That looks like a fun project. And I would challenge your board today that it's time to do it again, because those are old. Spend the money, get a producer in, and do it again, because those still might be very relative videos, and the ones that we replaced when we did it the last time were still very relative videos to the situation at hand that we have today. But still, you know, it's nobody wants to watch a video with a 10-year-old salvage cutter or a 10-year-old combine in it. They want to see the new stuff when they're doing that to keep them interactive in it. But everybody's insurance company provide videos also. If you've got any kind of reputable insurance company, you can talk to your agent. They have all kinds of libraries of those that you can use to train your guys or gals. I'm not sexist in it. Some of my best truck drivers are definitely not guys, but train your crew. Utilize all that information because they won't let you buy people anymore.
Anymore. Get out of here. swear. So yes, we did those safety videos in 2013, 2012. If you do new ones, I might kind of throw a fit because I spent a good 2 weeks nonstop editing those to put them on YouTube.
So, you're really good at it now.
Yeah. So I have lots of practice.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah. So tell me specifically, I know you go to Georgia March, April. Tell me kind of
we'll
your...
we'll be heading down late February, March sometime. We've got another job back. We lost a few years ago. We got it back this year, so we'll be heading back down earlier this year to do a bunch of triticale. Stop we've had for, I think, next year is 20 years on the one stop we've got. That stop's about an hour east of Atlanta. So we run right down the big road. We're really jealous of the wheat harvesters that get to travel on two-lane roads with nice wide berms. Our roads are wider because they have 8 lanes of traffic going each direction on them. So that makes it exciting when you head towards Atlanta.
Yeah, but going through Atlanta hauling choppers sounds like so much fun. But you do it twice a year.
Usually. Twice a year, yeah. You got to go around Atlanta. You technically can't go through Atlanta. There's big fines if you travel the interstate straight through town. You've got to go the belt out around, which adds like 20 miles and bunch of screwing around. But yeah, so you got to drive the Atlanta Motor Speedway around the perimeter of it where everybody does 90-95.
Motor Speedway.
If you're not going 90, you're getting past if you're in a car. So
where do you go after near Atlanta?
So when we get done in Georgia in the spring, we come back home and plant our little bit of crops that we farm and then get ready to go back down to Georgia to cut corn silage in late June, early July. Corn in Georgia. And this year we went from corn in Georgia. They had some late corn. It was really wet in Georgia this spring. So we ended up harvesting that late corn and then came back home. We had 3 days at home to get everything cleaned back up and ready to go before we had to start in Western Ohio. Western Ohio corn has been really slow at drying down in our part of the world this year. So we were held up there plenty long. It was slow drying down in Michigan also. So by the time we got up in Michigan, everything was still good to go.
So that worked.
Yeah, we're thinking it was the smoke. The Canadian smoke is what everybody's blaming it on because it was so fogged over for so long. We weren't getting growing degree units accumulating like it should have been. If you look at all the charts, they say we got the growing degree units, but we must not have been getting any UV accumulation because stuff's just not drying.
But it is now, right?
It's finally turned and
first week of October.
Fine. Yeah. Normally we're done and home by now, but it's rained, I don't know, almost an inch right now. So who knows how long we're going to be here now. It's turned to mud. So it's going to be a mud bog for a while.
Do you think you'll have to pull the trucks?
We'll either be pulling trucks or we've got some side dump carts. So we could be running some side dump carts, carrying it to the edge of their field and dumping that way. But they don't have a driveway for the truck to park on or some of the places we could dump on the dirt road and that'll work. In 19, it was an absolute disaster in Michigan for mud. The whole part of this part of the country was horrible in 19 for mud. So everybody will remember 19 until the day they die, probably. And we worked for a long time up here with carts, and we were dumping on the road then. We'd actually drag the mud right out on the road and dump because there was no place for the truck to get there. But the counties and townships actually let the farmers close the roads so that we could do that.
Wow.
And then they cleaned the mud off the road when we were done, as good as they could. But it made some enemies. I mean, there's some people that were pretty angry, and the harvest had to happen.
Yeah, cows, well, enjoy your milk.
That's right.
Enjoy your milk.
Your cheese on your pizza and your hamburger at Wendy's. And
what brand of tow ropes do you use? I'm just curious.
We make our own. We had a neighbor for years made ropes for us. He was an Amishman, and he moved to Pennsylvania, and he still made our ropes, twisted our ends in for us, braided our ends. So we're just using 2-inch, just raw 2-inch nylon rope, and we cut it to length and braid our own ends in. It's a very economical method of doing your own nylon tow ropes. You can find it on YouTube on how to braid them back in. And you can buy lengths of 2-inch rope or 3-inch rope pretty cheap.
Awesome. So I didn't expect that answer.
We got a short rope on the back of the choppers, and we got longer ropes if trucks get stuck. We need a big tractor out in the field. So yeah, and you use them for a while and they start to get a little ugly, you just throw them away. Because I can buy a 300-foot spool of 2-inch nylon rope for about the same price as I can buy a big Bubba rope or a York strap or something like that.
So if you guys want to follow Orson Custom Farming, OCF Crew, I know on Facebook, Instagram.
Yep.
Are you on TikTok? Does Justin have you
Megan
guys on TikTok?
Megan does some TikTok. Megan? At Lady Farmore. My daughter is one of the business partners in OCF. Justin shoots the videos usually. If there's a video of a drone in the air on any of those on Facebook or Instagram, that's Justin doing that.
I knew that part because you guys have some pretty cool drone videos I've seen. So check out OCF Crew. Check out
Lady Farmore, I think is what
Lady Farm Orr. And Orr is O-R-R. And they have some really cool videos. Keep up with them. Thank you, John, for taking time today. I'm glad it rained so we could catch you in the hotel room and chat a little bit. So
it'd been more fun if I was in the silage cutter talking to the trucks, and it'd been a lot more realistic. And
well, I know.
That's your load. Take it on out of here.
Yeah.
Idiot, why'd you turn that way? And, you know, all those things.
All the G-rated.
All the G-rated words that we always use for the
version.
Truck drivers. That
always.
Was not very smart. You should have maybe turned the other direction. Let's make our choices better next time.
There was, so I was doing a Facebook Live with Michael and Pratt, and someone put tires in the back of Kim's pickup, and she was pulling a camper, and it was a fifth wheel. And so when she went to turn, like, it stopped her pickup really fast.
Yep.
And so I asked Michael a couple days later, I said, hey, what happened there? He's like, oh, this hired man put tires in the back. And I was like, oh boy, how'd that go? He said, well, we just stopped at lunch. And I asked him, what kind of headspace were you in? What were you thinking when you did that? And I said, or my dad, in your method of telling someone they messed up, very, very different. That is not how that was. I would have been cursed and yelled. And so good for Michael.
Why good for Michael? Look how good you turned out. See, your dad's method worked.
I guess.
You wouldn't do that, would you? You wouldn't have put tires in the back of a vehicle with a fifth wheel on it. So.
But I grew up doing this stuff, so that's a difference too.
Yeah, we all screw up, but yeah, sometimes it's difficult to hold the tongue.
What were you thinking is definitely not something that I've ever heard come out of my dad's mouth. Like, what were you kind of thinking when you did that? That's not.
You know, what was your headspace? Your dad would ask where your head was at, and maybe
he would have told me where he suggested where it was probably at.
Where that's it probably was. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
So similar.
Maybe pull it out of where.
Yeah. Yeah. Remove your head from there.
Yes. Yeah.
Speaking of where your head's at, I see that Kansas City shirt there. Yeah. Okay.
Listen. I am from Kansas. I have been a Chiefs fan. I like Taylor Swift, though. I like her songs. I have nothing against Taylor Swift. What I'm mad about is that the NFL is just, I don't need to flash after a touchdown to see Taylor Swift. I don't need that.
Trying to ride her wave.
Oh, well. I'm also jealous because Travis Kelce is not bad to look at. Uh-huh. So
We were talking about this at lunch today. I said, think about his mother. So when she's got two boys in the Super Bowl, that was a lot of press last year. And this is cool.
Amazing.
Because when a parent gets a child in professional sports, any professional sports, all of a sudden, you know, they're going to step up a little bit. Son's going to buy him or daughter's going to buy him a new car, maybe, you know, thanks mom and dad,
Right.
You're the one that helped drive me into this. Or maybe a house comes down the road for me. They live it up a little bit. His mom is looking at him right now and saying, son, don't screw this up. She's got $800 million and I can go shopping for my own custom-made leather purse in Italy on her private jet.
Yeah, but he's got his own money.
If you don't, not like that. Not like that.
You think it's real or you think it's staged? The whole,
I don't know.
The whole thing.
I get sick of sports. Sports were put here to entertain us all. They don't notice what's going on in the left side or the right side while they're keeping us. Just like the lion fights against the men back in the Roman days. We would keep the population occupied while we're stealing and screwing them out of their earnings.
All right, Biden fans. Let's stop. I know where we're heading, and we're going to stop it here.
I'm not heading anywhere. Okay.
All right, guys. Thanks for listening. Thank you, John, for joining. Everybody, we've got David Misener with Green Acres Enterprises on with us. And David, go ahead and introduce yourself.
My name's David Misener, and I am from Elk City, Oklahoma.
And David is a grain harvester. So tell me what you got going on today. What's in the background? Why do you have time to talk to me?
It is raining, and very pleased to have the rain here. Yeah, it started last night, and it's supposed to rain all day today, all tonight. Tomorrow. So yeah, maybe we'll get a couple inches out of this. We are in the state of South Dakota seeing this right now.
What part of the state are you in? Like central, east, west?
South central. We're West River, right close to the Missouri River and close to Nebraska. Yeah, we're kind of about 20 miles from Nebraska and about 20 miles to the Missouri River.
Oh, I didn't know you were that close to Nebraska. What crop are you cutting right now?
We've been doing a lot of soybeans lately. We've done some corn. Still have a fair amount of beans to do in this region as well yet. A lot of corn yet to do.
How's the crop up there this year?
Crop here is above average. We've done a few beans that have been average, but as a whole, beans have been above average. So that's a lot of excitement from all the farmers, and grain bins are full already on some situations. And yeah, they had a lot of good moisture, and just it was nice to have them hit that win, and a lot of fun. And of course, you want to get after it then too, because the crop's been good and we've had pretty much some really good weather, but we've also had some fog. Well, it is. It's farming.
Tell us about Green Acres Enterprises' trek basically throughout the year. You start in May.
Yes, that's correct. We start down at home combine in Oklahoma, and we go from there in May, and then sometime in June, we usually finish there. And we also do a lot of planting of cotton when we're down at home. So there's a little bit of crossing back and forth between trying to keep the combines rolling and the planter rolling. And then we get into Kansas and do wheat there in Nebraska, and have a couple stops in South Dakota, and same in North Dakota. And then we come back this time of the year in October, and we do the soybeans and corn before it's time to get home a little after Halloween to finish our year and harvest that cotton that we planted back in May and June.
So for the listeners, I wanted to interview David, not only because he happens to be my board president, and because he has kind of a special story. So his wife is from Germany, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. And then you have four kids. I was like, I was thinking all their names. I was counting.
Yeah, Alexander, Sarah, Paul, and Maria.
Yeah. Yes. So what do your kids do August, September, October? If you are in South Dakota,
they go to school. Right now, they are in the town of Gregory. They go to school here. We're about 2 miles from the school. School here starts about 8 o'clock. So we just have breakfast with everybody all together, the crew and everyone in the morning, bring the kids into school and they go to school. And then at 3 o'clock when it's over, we'll go back and pick them up. A lot of times the kids will come out and help harvesting or whatever we need to do. Or our daughter Sarah is in volleyball. So actually this afternoon there is another volleyball game. So she's going to be a part of that.
Dad gets to make a volleyball game.
That's right. So thank goodness for the rain, because that's the first one I've gotten to see. And the kids actually went to school when we were up in North Dakota there as well. Yeah. Our youngest one, Paul, he was in cross country, or youngest boy, Paul, he was in cross country and really enjoys running and did well there. And he, so kids get to do some of that. And of course, by the time we get home in November, then they go home to school there, our local school. And so they get to jump around and see a lot of kids and a lot of friends everywhere.
So needless to say, that's kind of why being a harvest kid is great, because you just know how to talk to people. I mean, those kids go to school for a couple months in one totally different state. That's super rare. And then they go back home to Oklahoma for the rest of the school year. Can they do basketball? If they did sports in another state, can they come back home and do another sport?
So the basketball part, they haven't done. The volleyball, I'm not sure if we were discussing that a little bit when we get home, where they're going to be at. I think they're going to be done with volleyball in Oklahoma. Our son Alexander has done golf at home, but that's spring, and same with the track and such. So that works out pretty good. But like the cross country, it was nice. They got to be a part of that up north in North Dakota. And so there is a little bit of crossover there. And like Alexander, he's in the FFA class here too, in Gregory. So that's good, and going to do it when we get home. So there's some of that they get to do in more than one state.
Do they keep in touch with their Gregory classmates when they're not there the rest of the year?
They do, all of them. I can say just yesterday, when our mail came in the mail, which we're lucky enough to only have to see them bills once a week instead of every day.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then when they come, there's more of them.
Right. Then you have a big old pile.
That's right. But no, the kids actually had, I think there was 4 letters in the mail that was for our kids from, there was some from North Dakota and some from Elk City, that friends and, you know, just writing letters and how you doing. And, you know, not just that phone call back and forth or, you know, something of that nature. But yeah, we definitely encourage our kids to get that letter sent. And Alexander actually got a letter from a girl that he knows through going to the U.S. Custom Harvesters meeting in January all the time. So kind of nice too. So
cool. Good. And tell them to keep those letters, because it surprised me. I know you're not too much into technology, so I'm not surprised that you said that. But other parents might be like, oh yeah, they're on Facebook or they're on Twitter, Instagram. Yeah. Those old school letters, tell them to keep those, because I have some from my best friends when I was in grade school, like second, third, fourth, fifth grade, from when I was on Harvest and my friends wrote to me. So they're really cool to read years later. That's good. Good. I'm glad they do that.
Yeah.
The other thing I wanted to talk about is, like I said, Verena is from Germany. Talk a little bit about how you guys met and kind of what she thought of the United States when she got here, how often you guys go back, things like that.
Verena came, almost 20 years ago today was the first time that we met.
Wow, cool.
Yeah, it's getting very close to that. But anyways, so she came on a J-1 visa through her university and wanting to learn something about American agriculture and go back home to her family farm and do that. She found something that she just didn't want to leave here in America. So then she ended up is still here. And so, So anyways, eventually we got married. We got married in Germany and do custom harvesting. And actually this morning we went into the local school and spoke with the FFA crowd and just encouraged about going places and doing something else. And that's what Verena did. She came here because she wanted to learn and see something else and wanted to go at home. She had their family has a lot of pigs. So she did animal science, the university, got a master's degree in that, technically saying she's not using that degree at all. But she was glad that she did it.
A lot of people don't. It's okay.
Yeah, that's right. But she is enjoying that she did it. And yeah, it was really cool and fun that she got to do that. And she got to learn something. And but she still was outgoing enough, willing to try something different because she did that schooling that she had. She's learned to help use that same situation to figure out things that she never thought she'd be a part of. And, you know, glad to be here in America.
So I've noticed, like, when we have to make board decisions or personal decisions about things, or you guys really talk to each other a lot. Like, even when you write your president's letters for our monthly magazine, like, I can tell Verena helped you. Not like in a bad way. You guys, get each other's opinions, and you
we
really
value
work
it a
together.
Lot. That's just the way we do it. We like with the whole harvesting that we do when we're going somewhere or whatever, we decide and we think about it and, you know, plan it out. And because it definitely works a lot better with our decisions together and stepping forward in the same direction instead of trying to split apart, and you know, it goes smooth and
right.
We like it together.
Yeah. Good call. Good decision, Verena, to come to the United States. Who knew,
right?
That's funny how so many little decisions affect things. The main, I guess, topic of this podcast, our second episode, is to talk about why in the heck you became a harvester, that mindset, and then how you actually did it. So your story, I know, begins, was your dad the first one to harvest, or his dad?
My grandpa actually did some harvesting. We always did harvesting around home. I was actually born in Watertown, South Dakota.
And which is why David does not have an accent. You have a northern accent to me.
Yes, and very close to Minnesota.
Yes. Yes.
So,
is he from Oklahoma? He does not sound like he's from Oklahoma. It's like you've probably got a little bit of Verena's accent. You think after like 20 years, you probably...
Oh yeah.
Probably hear that.
Mm. Yeah, there is some of that, and you know, but grandpa farmed and did custom work for some neighbors, and then dad did the same, and likewise myself. And then what was it, about 2000, we decided to move to Oklahoma, and we started doing more and more custom work. Then I did it with my father for quite a few years, and then he passed a little over 10 years ago, surprise, and so it is. So, but I always enjoyed farming and driving tractor and combine and whatnot, and didn't want to stop, and so I didn't. And of course, Raina just doing it with me and her enjoying that, we didn't want to stop doing that, so we definitely continued and still are. We enjoy it. It is. It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to travel and to know so many people everywhere and need something or whatever. You got somebody else you can call or find out.
And that's kind of, we've touched on a little bit in a couple different interviews, but that's a little bit why you've become a member of U.S. Custom Harvesters a long time ago as well. How did that kind of help you in your journey?
It's knowing somebody else, asking, hey, you know, I've got, for instance, I've got a job that I can't cover, calling somebody else and said, hey, can you do this one? And then, of course, it comes back likewise. Maybe they can't do it and they'll call me and say, hey, can you do it? And then there's plenty of times, too, somebody that called that wasn't down in Oklahoma and they took in a rock this year. And they're like, oh, no, they didn't want to go buy a set of brand new concaves because they had concaves at home, but they lived up in Kansas, and they said, David, I'm not from far from your house. You don't have by chance a usable set of concaves, do you? And I said, yeah,
of course.
Yeah, of course I got concaves for a combine. Just come over and get them. And, you know, and then all said and done, you know, the guy asked, what do I owe you? I said, nothing. You know, you helped me out. Here it is. I'm helping you out. You know, it's just being a neighbor. Yeah. And so, you know, it did. It made a big difference. They didn't use them very many hours. They were able to get their job done and save some money and get up, and they had a good set of concaves at home. So then it worked out for everybody. So that's nice about having that connection. But that only came from being members and with U.S. Custom Harvesters.
When you were telling that story, I got to thinking about our shop, my dad's big blue shop. Mm-hmm. You've been there. I went there one day and there was a truck with just a low boy. And I was like, what's going on? It said something harvesting on the side. And he's like, oh, so-and-so stopped by. We unloaded the combine down at the bins because he's got trouble with this tire and this one has trouble with this tire. So I just told him to back it up to the shop and we'll do this, this, and this. And, you know, my dad and this guy had never met, but this guy saw a big shop and he's like, man, I hope this guy can help me out. And he happened to be another harvester and they happened to both be members. And so it's really cool when that happens to help each other out. What was your harvester, holy crap, I'm doing this moment? Like, was it when you bought your first combine just by yourself and you saw the loan papers? Was it, you know, when you first totally left home without your dad? What was your, oh my gosh, this is, I'm in now?
God, I never really thought of that before.
Just kind of eased into it?
Yeah, it just like, you know, when I was in high school, you know, I can say, I just enjoyed it when I didn't have to go to school or got out of school early or something like that. Cause I went and I drove the tractor and planted or harvested or whatever it was. I just always enjoyed doing that and getting to do it when I was really
young. So it was always your plan.
Yeah. Yeah. I just, you know, like I remember Christmas and my birthday's close to Christmas time. And mom's like, well, what do you want for Christmas? And I said, oh, I'd take another toy tractor or something. And she's like, oh, come on, you got to have something else besides the tractor. And I'm like, no. And then, you know, Christmas would come and I'd get whatever. And then if I didn't get something, you know, for that, then birthday comes around. Well, what do you want for your birthday? Well, I was kind of asking for this for Christmas and I didn't get it. So I think I'd like that for my birthday. And, you know, it was usually a tractor or something. It's just,
yeah.
I always have enjoyed that farming aspect.
It's just fun. That's how my oldest brother is. Like he didn't even want to be in school. He said, I know what I'm doing out on the farm. I'd rather be in a tractor. I don't even want to be here. Like there was no question what he was ever going to do. And it's funny you say the tractors, because as a parent, you know this. I was talking to Trish Skimper the other day and she said, I had to run into John Deere for parts after hours and I had to take the boys. And I was like, oh, it's after hours. They're not open. You know, you guys stay in the pickup. Well, of course they come in and they find, I want this tractor. I want this tractor. Like, I don't know how many, I'm sure your kids are like this too, but we have a huge basket of farm toys. Huge.
Yeah.
You don't need any more. We have every color. We have every, like, but you know, it's always, oh, look at this one. Look at this one.
Yeah. It's awesome. And I was always that way. I wanted one more and I played with them all the time. It just did. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
When in doubt,
bring farm toys anywhere.
It always works.
Bring them.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you always knew you were going to do it. Well, that makes
sense. Yeah. And it was like, I was the first one in my high school class that knew what they were going to do after high school too. I mean, there were, you know, you have the career days or, you know, which school you're going to go to. And I just, myself, it was easy. Lake Area Votech was right there. It was close ag production. And I just said, well, I'm going to go there. And they're like, well, don't you want to look somewhere else? And I did. And I'm like, yeah, but I'm still going to go there because I can't be home and own tractor and I don't have to spend the night at school. If I'm not at school, then I want to be in the tractor if I can. You know, granted, you can't do that in the winter, but I can also say to try and help keep that process going of being in the tractor, there was a few times I drove the tractor to school because I moved snow beforehand, and so I could still do that.
So I was a couple months ago, I was roading a combine just to town real quick for my dad, and my dad lives a couple miles from where my kids go to school, and I wasn't going to make it back home in time for the bus. So I was like, do I just take this combine to the school and pick up my kids? I was like, I bet I can make it. I was like, I'm not going to take it there. So I did not make it home in time. But my oldest is old enough to watch the other two for a couple minutes. So I feel like it's pretty rare that you know what you want to do. You want to know what school you want to go to. But I was the exact same ever since like fifth, sixth grade. I was like, I want to manage a huge company and I want to manage and I want to do this and I want to be a secretary or an executive assistant. That's what I always wanted to do. I always wanted to do business school. I always wanted to do that. Never changed my mind. And I think what got me doing that is my mom made me do their bank statements. Like you know, back in the day when they'd give you your checks back.
Yep.
And I would go through the checks and I'd check them off on the bank statement when I was in like fourth, fifth grade. So that just, I wanted to do all the organizing and planning, and operations manager wasn't in my head, but the title doesn't matter. It's what you did.
Idea. You're doing that thing that you wanted. And it's fun.
It's great. It's awesome.
And it's neat that some do have that idea, but not, like you say, not, we got not one person here that's working. One person that's helping us right now, and she actually had every intent that she wanted to be a school teacher. And so she decided, I think I'm going to go for a little bit to help travel. And she decided to kind of be a nanny for a few months. And she did that. And she quickly learned, I can't deal with school children. And so now she's driving a combine and tractor and cart for us. So, you know, and she's having a heyday. And so she's like, no, this is more the thing for me. I got to do farming.
Yeah.
She grew up on a farm, but she thought maybe something else, but you got to be willing to try it. And then you can find out sometimes maybe that isn't the right thing.
When you know yourself too, like me, I'm not a teacher for a good reason. That's not for me. And it's nice, like you didn't even go to school in Elk City, did you? You went to school up north, right?
Just up South Dakota. Yeah.
So they probably understood farming and if you didn't have to be at school. And so It's kind of funny you said that, because I remember vividly, I can see in the classroom where I was sitting. I was in seventh grade, and I can see myself in the classroom where I was sitting, and my teacher came in and said, "Your mom called and says you need to go run the grain cart." And she was like mad at me. And I was a pretty good student. Like, I could miss a day of school and it would be okay. Yeah. But she did not understand. Your parents think harvest is more important than school. And it just, like, she was mad. I could tell she was mad. Yeah. You know, usually in small towns, they get it, but
not everybody does. And I can say I've done that with our school too. There's called the school and said to the school bus back at home, "Hey, if it's fine." And I've got this school bus driver's number too. And I said,
"Take him by the field.
Drop Alexander, bring him to this field and tell him to drive the tractor home," you know, and he just, you know, just does it or whatever. And I can say, even here, like where we're at, there was a couple of years ago, we had to go through town and do this out, whatever. And I sent one of the boys, I says, "Go into Senex and stop there and fill the tractor up, you know, get the key, of course, you know, fill the tractor up with fuel and sign the ticket and go on to the next field. And this is where it's at." And did it, came into town later and it's like, "I'm surprised your son can do it," but he just does it perfect. You know, you don't worry about it when he drives in there. He does it and he does it right. You know it.
And that's the nice thing about radios too. Like, if you say, "Hey, tell my kid to get in the tractor and call me on the radio." That's what my parents always did. Yep. Call me on the radio and I'll tell her what to do. It's a different way to grow up for sure.
Yeah.
But like I said earlier, your kids know how to talk to people. They've met all different types of people. And I'd like to, one of these episodes, probably get Alexander on.
Oh, yeah.
And we can just chat.
We'll be able to do that. Oh, he'd be smiling. You know that. He did it before with you, too. You'd both had a payday.
Yes. Yeah. If you guys want to check it out, I did do a Facebook Live with Alexander. Was it just last year?
Yeah, it was last year.
Just
on your birthday.
Year ago?
Yeah, just a little over
it
a year ago
on my
your birthday.
So it was June of 2022. I interviewed Alexander. And at that time, how old would he have been, David?
Let's see. He would have been 13 then.
Okay. So he's in the combine. We do a Facebook Live video. Check out US Custom Harvesters on Facebook. Check out our videos. I've done all sorts of live videos, fun ones. And that's a good one with Alexander. It's pretty cool. The cool thing is his aunt in Germany watched?
Yes, that's correct. Yep,
yeah.
She did. Yep.
She commented on it. I was like, "Oh my gosh, look, Alexander." So it was pretty fun.
Yeah. No, it was. It was a good day. Yeah. You both did well.
So, okay. Well, thank you, David, for letting me bug you on a rain day. I know you have all sorts of parts and maintenance and fun things to do. So thanks for joining.
Little bill collecting. Got to do it.
Yes. All right. We appreciate it.
You bet. Bye. Thank you.
Guys, last part of the podcast. Here we go. I'm going to let you know about some U.S. Custom Harvesters organization updates. Basically, just what I in the office want you to know or what I've been emailing you guys about. All right. The first thing, which is hopefully you've all been aware of, is our K exemption. So to give you a little bit of background, Custom Harvesters have had the 391.2 exemption for 25, 30 years, the number in the Federal Register is 391.2, which basically says if you're a custom harvest crew, you do not have to have a medical card if you have a CDL, and you can get a CDL under the age of 21. But it was not clarified if you can cross state lines if you're under 21 with that CDL. So usually when you get a CDL, you have a K restriction on your license. That means you cannot cross state lines, which obviously for a custom harvester is a big problem because probably 90% of their work is across state lines. So back in 2017, we requested an exemption to that K restriction, and it was granted from the FMCSA, which is the Federal Motor Carriers Association. I missed a word in there. You know where I'm coming from, the DOT. And they granted it for 5 years. So in those 5 years, there were lots of stipulations attached to that. You had to report an accident within 5 days if the accident was someone under 21 with a CDL. You also had to report it a certain way, report it to us, to U.S. Custom Harvesters, lots of things going on there. So that exemption expired this year. We requested it to be renewed back in March. Actually didn't expire till October. We were granted a 2-year exemption again, but with lots of provisions. A couple of the provisions that you members really need to be aware of. If you have an accident, again, within 5 days, you need to call me, email me, whatever. There's a form that I have to have you fill out. And again, if these stipulations aren't followed, we don't get this exemption renewed. And it's important for a lot of harvesters. Besides the 5-day reporting period, and I think you guys have seen this in plenty of emails from me, and you're going to see it in the monthly magazine, I really need you to get me your DOT number, because the list of DOT numbers that I have is provided to the DOT, and that is the list they work off of. Because this exemption is only for members of U.S. Custom Harvesters, the ones that provide me with their DOT numbers. So let's say next year, you're a Custom Harvesters member of our organization, and you get in an accident, and the cops are talking to you, and it's someone under 21 with the CDL. So they look at that list, and they say, we don't have your DOT number. You're going to be in some trouble. So please, please text the office, email me, call, whatever you have to do. Please get me your DOT number. Can I look up your DOT number? Yes, I can. It's public information. But do I have time to sit here and look up 450 DOT numbers? Not really. So please, please get those DOT numbers to me. A couple more things. H-2A stuff. Yay. Y'all are aware of the H-2A final rule that was passed in, I want to say this February of 2023. That is a final rule. Final means final. So you have to abide by all those wage rates this upcoming year. If you had your job orders and your everything submitted before, I want to say it was March 30th, you're okay for this year, but next year it's coming. So please be aware of those wage rates that come out, especially the new one that comes out in July, because now they come out twice a year. It used to be once a year. The other H-2A issue that I've emailed about is two new proposed rules came out. Again, these are proposed, so the comment period on them is open. So please, please feel free to comment. I'm not going to go through all the stipulations of it again because it's not law yet, but basically what it's doing is making the employers walk a much, much, much finer line and not giving you very many days to respond to any issues. It's giving the employees or the H-2A workers a lot more protection and a lot more freedom. Please check into that if you're an H-2A employer. I know we have a lot of crews out there that if they didn't have H-2A employees, they wouldn't be able to operate their business. And I know if you're listening and you're not sure why don't Custom Harvest crews just hire American workers? They would absolutely love to, because it would be much, much cheaper and a lot easier, much less paperwork, much cheaper for them. But as you know, Custom Harvest crews can be gone from home from March to July, September to November. Grain crews are gone from May to November. So it's really hard to find people that have a family and things going on that are okay with leaving home for that long. Just very, very hard to find workers. Labor is absolutely the number one issue in the custom harvesting industry. And we will do a podcast about that sometime soon. So stay tuned. But please check out those two new proposed rules and comment on them. I will email you a comment template and we'll go from there. So keep an eye out for that. A few more things. Make sure you register for the convention. If you are an associate member, which is someone that provides a product or service for custom harvesters, please make sure you're registered to attend and have a booth. That's the number one way to reach the owners of these crews, is to be at that trade show at the convention. If you are a harvester member, registration opened October 1st. Also check your mailboxes, because I did send out registration packets and dues renewal forms. So please, please check your mail or just log in online and follow the instructions that I've emailed out. Another issue with the convention, if the hotel nights are full, or if you're not able to book in our block, chances are that it's just one night that is full. So I would recommend booking the days that are available and then book that one night at a different hotel. There are tons of hotels like 2-3 blocks away, guys. You're going to have somewhere to stay, I promise. And then book that night, and then come actual convention time, that night might open up that you need it at the host or overflow hotel. These hotels are booked within a couple months of me sending out the links. So I usually send out the links in February, March. They're pretty full come June, July-ish. So you've got to really, really pay attention and get those hotels booked for convention. Also, if you have extra rooms that you know you're not going to need or extra nights, please cancel those, because those people waiting to get in that block can get in. The reason I don't add more rooms to the block is because when you do cancel those rooms and no one takes them, guess who has to pay for it? U.S. Custom Harvesters. We are full. Book what you can, and then I promise you'll be able to find a hotel room close. Last thing, stay safe as this season wraps up, okay? I know a lot of you are working on corn, beans, Milo, getting done with those fall crops. Please stay safe. Go the speed limit. Stop at the stop signs. I don't like sending those emails out where someone was hurt or passes away. Please don't make me do that. So stay safe out there. Those of you starting cotton harvest, like we are getting ready to here in Kansas and Oklahoma, please be safe getting that equipment ready. Blow the cotton off those cotton strippers and pickers so they don't start on fire. And just communicate with each other. Stay in touch. Stay safe. I will talk to y'all on the next podcast that is uploaded every other Wednesday. Custom Harvest Hype. Find us on YouTube. Find us on all the places that you find podcasts. Have an awesome 2 weeks. I'll talk to y'all soon.